Moby Dick by Herman Melville, adapted by David Zane Merowitz and starring F. Murray Abraham.
What the white whale was to Captain Ahab will soon be told. What at times he was to me must here be said. Aside from those more obvious considerations touching Moby Dick, which could awaken some alarm in any man's soul, there was another thought, or rather vague, nameless horror concerning him, which at times, by its intensity, completely overpowered all the rest. And yet so mystical was it that I almost despair of putting it in a comprehensible form. It was the whiteness of the whale that above all things appalled me.
Call me Ishmael. Some years ago, never mind how long precisely, having little or no money in my purse and nothing particular to interest me on shore, I thought I would sail about a little and see the watery part of the world. Whenever I find myself growing grim about the mouth, whenever it is a damp, drizzly November in my soul, whenever I find myself involuntarily pausing before coffin warehouses and bringing up the rear of every funeral I meet, then I account it high time to get to sea as soon as I can. When I say that I am in the habit of going to sea whenever I begin to grow hazy about the eyes and overconscious of my lungs, I don't mean that I ever go as a passenger. No. When I go to sea, I go as a simple sailor, right before the mast, plumb down into the forecastle, aloft there to the royal masthead. True, the mates rather order me about some, and make me jump from spar to spar like a grasshopper in a May meadow. And that kind of treatment touches one's sense of honor, especially if just previous to putting your hand into the tar pot, you've been lording it as a country schoolmaster. The transition is a keen one, I assure you, from schoolmaster to sailor. Doubtless this formed part of the grand program of Providence that was drawn up for me a long time ago. Why, after having repeatedly smelt the sea as a merchant sailor, I should now take it into my head to go on a whaling voyage, this, the invisible police officer of the fates, who watches me constantly, who secretly dogs me, and influences me in some unaccountable way, he can answer better than anyone else. Because of these things, then, the whaling voyage was welcome. The great floodgates of the wonder world swung open, and in the wild conceits that swayed me to my purpose, there floated into my inmost soul endless processions of the whale. And midmost of them all, one grand hooded phantom, like a snow hill in the air. Moby Dick. New Bedford, Massachusetts. Such dreary streets. Blocks of blackness, not houses, on either side. And here and there a candle. A candle moving about in a tomb. The Spouter Inn. Peter Coffin. Coffin? Spouter? Who would rather not be in Sumatra than here? Go down to the fiery pit itself to keep out this frost. But no more of this blubbering now, Ishmael. We are going a-whaling, and there's plenty of blubbering yet to come. Let's scrape the ice from our frosted feet and see what sort of place this spouter in may be.
Well, you know, I didn't hear much because A room for the night. Oh, the house is full, not a bed unoccupied.
Oh.
Unless you ain't no objections to sharing a harpooner's blanket.
Hmm?
I suppose you are going a whaling, so you'd better get used to that sort of thing.
I don't like sleeping two in a bed, but it depends on who the harpooner might be.
Oh, him? Oh, he's a dark complexioned chap. He eats nothing but steaks, and he likes them rare.
Does he always keep such late hours?
No, but tonight he went out to peddling. And maybe he can't sell his head.
Can't sell his head? Do you pretend to say, landlord, that this harpooner is actually engaged this blessed night in peddling his head around the town?
That is precisely it. And I told him he couldn't sell it here, as the market is overstocked already.
Landlord, I demand you speak out and tell me whether I shall be in all respects safe to spend the night with this harpooner. I've no intention of sleeping with a madman.
Be easy. This here harpooner has just arrived from the South Seas, where he brought up a lot of embalmed New Zealand heads. And he sold them all of them but one. And that one he's trying to sell tonight, 'cause tomorrow's Sunday. And it would not do to be selling human heads about the streets when folks is going to church.
Oh. No man prefers sleeping two in a bed, not even with your own brother. I don't know how it is, but people like to be private when they're sleeping. And when it comes to sleeping with an unknown stranger, in a strange inn, in a strange town, and that stranger a harpooner, then your objections indefinitely multiply.
What I mean is, it lay more for sa. It lay for inga.
It's him. The harpooner. Look at that face. A dark purplish yellow color with large black squares tattooed on it. No hair on his head.
Too much.
Nothing but a small scalp knot twisted on his forehead. And the same squares tattooed all over his body.
Next time, no pearls to swine.
A peddler of heads? What if he takes a fancy to mine?
Hoki, hoki, tonu.
Here, we wouldn't harm a hair on your head.
Mm. Why didn't you tell me he was a cannibal?
Well, didn't I say he was peddling heads around town?
Oh, yes, but I didn't realize it, that...
Understand now. You get in bed. Share bed. Good.
There. You see, he means you no harm.
Well, tell him to stash his tomahawk there, or pipe, or whatever you call it. Now, tell him to stop smoking it, and I will turn in with him. I don't fancy having a man smoking in bed with me. It's dangerous. Besides, I ain't insured.
Now, are you staying or no?
Well, at least he's a clean enough looking cannibal. I better sleep with a sober cannibal than a drunken Christian, I suppose.
There's an essence. Whiteness. It's not so much a color as the visible absence of color. And at the same time, the most concrete of all colors.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.